Hello everyone, welcome to new improved Hub 76. Now, if you're wondering what Hub is the Holistic University of Brisbane, and this is node 76. And I've opened the Hub Art Gallery, and this is some of my work that I've been doing. Been taking some of Zoe's little toy dinosaurs and painting them based on the designs of birds. And I understand that dinosaurs evolved from birds. So this is the new improved rock garden. Carnivorous dinosaurs. This one's got a bit of a wax coating. It looks like guano has fallen on it. And there are the frilled dinosaurs, the ceratopsians, or keratopsians. I'm not sure how it's pronounced. And there's the long-necked dinosaurs, the sauropods, and yeah, this is what I've been making for my daughter Zoe. She haven't seen it yet, so I'm looking forward to showing it to her. And my neighbors were very irate about this little rock garden that I've been building. It's got some very nice rocks, and some of these are local rocks, the sandstone from the top of Tui Mountain, or what's left of it. And then this is all conglomerate sandstone from Tui Mountain, a beautiful orange sandstone. That's a thunder egg, as they call them, from Mount Tamarine. And Mount Tamarine is part of the outflow of what is symbolized here, which is my, this is how it all started, Mount Warning. Named by Captain Cook himself, and that's Mount Warning, and that's the tallest mountain in Queensland, I think, or southeast Queensland, Mount Barney. And Mount Barney has these same that's a painting that Sarah did of Mount Barney, based on a photograph that I took of these amazing cloud formations. And today we don't have any clouds in the sky at all here in the Antipodes. And that's a sign that I put up since all my birds disappeared. When I was locked up a few weeks ago, and I was locked up for running my taps, so I haven't been running them very much, just enough to keep my Venus flytraps alive. My Venus flytraps, they like to be in water all the time, so I have their roots wet. So this is the banyan tree. That was a bonsai that Sarah gave me, and I planted it in the ground because it gets these beautiful tap roots. And I planted this tree as well. This is a frangipani, to call it, or aralia. This is a sacred tree for Buddhists. And my ancestors were Buddhists. And I've adopted the Greek tradition of planting my baby's placenta underneath the tree. So that's where Zoe's placenta is buried. And these here are trees that I planted as well. That's not a tree, that's basil. That's not basil, that's dill. Smells beautiful. Very nice. And that's an evergreen tree that was given to me. It was taken from the rainforest by the same person who gave me this. His name is Paul or Paweł Obrocki. And he's Polish. And I don't take trees from forests, but if someone gives me a tree, I will try and keep it alive. So that's what I did. I planted this one myself. That's a cheese tree. This was given to me again by another friend. This is by a kwandong. It's a native tree that grows really fast. And it's a beautiful tree. So that's really close to my house. This is the an old house that was built by the American soldiers during the Second World War. That's one of my native birds, and these birds are very at home in this garden because that's where they were born. And they call them noisy miners because they have loud warning calls. So that's those are some of the birds from Dr. Romish's bird sanctuary. And this is the irrigation project that I has created so much consternation. My neighbors, they're afraid that I might be breeding rats in the long grass. And indeed, there are rats here, I cannot lie. But that's the way it is when you have a forest in your back garden. You get rats, and they live in that pile over there. And I built a little, I'm making a little pond, a little Sri Lanka, shaped like Sri Lanka, symbolized Sri Lanka. And this gets wet when it rains, and this was all unkept when I first moved here, and I'm slowly making some headway. It was full of junk. There's a beautiful spider web. I don't want to damage it, but I've got to walk through here and show you my spiderium. This is an old greenhouse that was built by an old Dutch man who lived here by the name of Ron Woudenberg. And it had fallen down, or it was supposed to have fallen down, full of junk. So I have encouraged the spiders. And that's where I've been taking these amazing photographs of these webs and spiders, and there are heaps of them. And that's a silver orb weaving spider. And I used to be very afraid of spiders when I was a child. And in fact, even when I was an adult, I was quite uncomfortable. I still don't like big spiders running on me, but I'm not really afraid of going close to them anymore. I used to be afraid of wasps and bees as well. That's got something to do with me baiting them with jam when I was a child. And one flew up my trouser leg and stung me. And I was about six, and I was very afraid of them after that. Now it's a cautionary tale. Yeah, so this is the other bit of my recent addition to my rock garden. It's a veggie patch, a little veggie patch. But my piece de resistance is this little pond shaped like Australia. And I painted some wallabies to make them look more realistic. And I placed them around this little play area for Zoe. And there are some mosquitoes breeding there, so I have to get the water flowing, because that gets rid of the mosquito larvae. That's why I have to turn the tap on again. And that's how I do it. I come around here to my other tap. That's a funny little sculpture that I made, which is dying because I stopped watering it. The moss on it. Okay, so that tap is going now. This tap is now filled. This area where I'm breeding frogs. There are, you get frog spawn. Coming down here. There's frog spawn. And the frogs lay the eggs up there, upstream, and it gets carried down here. And then it goes into these little ponds, where when I can get some sort of arrangement that the council should be running my water, enough to keep the ponds going, I'll be able to have frogs breeding here, and lots of them. But right now I'm just running it to show you how my little irrigation project works. This is a little solar panel which just gives a little ineffectual lighting. This is one of my little experiments with sculpture. It's a made out of bark, paper bark, and it's got glue and different stuff. Just it's a creature of some sort. I call it blue lizard. And that's a. I love these plants, and these are pitcher plants, carnivorous plants, like that big one down there. That's a big pitcher plant. Now, this tap is not running to the right place, and put it in here. And then you'll see my Sri Lanka, my Australia pond filling up. And there's a special little game that I play. You can pour different colored paints into these little flowing areas, and create colored panoramas. So this is this is what I've been doing with myself. And as you can see, my idea of gardening is rather different to that of my neighbors. But I'd really rather that they just got over it and didn't keep on locking me up. And they injected me 3 times with a drug that has sterilized me, made me gain 5 kilograms of weight, slowed me down, and made me much more prone towards diabetes, which I have a strong family history of anyway. And I think that's really cruel. And that sort of treatment, these drugs, shorten your life by 20 years on average. I'm 52, I don't want to shorten my life by 20 years. I don't want it shortened for me. And as for being paranoid, I sometimes get paranoid, and I have been paranoid lots of times in my life. But our whole political system is paranoid. And there's espionage all over. And sometimes when one's isolated, one becomes scared. And I got scared and worried about my daughter. And some of those fears were unwarranted. But sterilizing me and shortening my life and making me become fat is a very cruel way of dealing with a worried father. And if I don't turn up for another injection in 3 weeks' time, they'll send the police around and take me and lock me up again and inject me against my will. The last time I was locked up, I've been locked up 3 times in the last 3 months. And one time it was by a white South African guy. He said his name was Prince, P-R-I-N-S, pronounced Prince. And he told me he was a member of the Afrikaner Broederbond, which I understand is some sort of a political group of Afrikaners fighting for Afrikaner nationalism. And this is a suburb with a very big population of black Africans. And it is of great concern to me that we have this kind of thug coming around to people's houses and treating them the way they treated Africans in Africa. And I have had police coming around more than 10 times since I started doing this little irrigation project and bit of landscaping. And I've had noise complaints when I've been playing my music. And you can hear the sawing of the trees. They never get noise complaints for that. And never get noise complaints for revving cars and for revving motorbikes. But I get more noise complaints for playing music. And then I get complaints for running my taps, even though I pay my bills for the water. And it gets expensive to run your taps. But they do a thing called fracking, where the mining companies get their water really cheap and they pour heaps in to extract things from the ground. And I'm hydrating the ground, which makes it good for the ground and good for the plants. And I don't see why I should pay thousands of dollars to the Brisbane City Council water board. So, yeah. Anyway, I've had my little vent. And yeah, thank you for watching me on my YouTube channel.